Glenn Hopp, coming to you from Detroit in the late summer of 2010. Earlier this year, I started a small business hand-dyeing cotton-knit fabrics for clothing. I love wearing cotton, as you can see from my t-shirt. I also love color. I use two kinds of techniques when I'm dyeing fabric. Low water immersion and high water immersion. I'm going to show you today low water immersion using both wet and dry fabric to show you the difference that the wetness of the fabric makes when you're dyeing. I'm using roughly equal amounts of a beautiful cotton interlock from Dharma Trading Company. It is a total of 66 inches wide after it shrunk, so there's a lot of fabric, and it is tubular, so there are no selvage edges. What I'm going to do first with the dry length of fabric is open it up so that the fold lines don't cause any strange dye patterns. Then I'm going to simply crumple it into an empty bucket. I'll do the same thing with the wet fabric. This is going to give us a mottled effect. We're going to use very little water with the dye, which is why it's called low water immersion dyeing. I have the damp fabric here. I'll also open that up. This has simply been wet and then spun dry in the washing machine. And I'll crumple that into the second bucket. And the only difference, one is wet, one is dry. Roughly the same amount of yardage. I think I have a yard and a third of the fabrics, and they're both the cotton interlock. I've pre-mixed water with soda ash. Soda ash is essential when you're using fiber reactive dyes or Procyon MX type dyes. Fiber reactive dyes are wonderful for cottons, bamboo, rayon, and linen. And they can be used with slightly different techniques with silk and wool. The color that I'm using today is also from Dharma Trading. It's their Brilliant Blue. And I've pre-mixed that in a fairly strong concentration in my little bucket here. Now, the three ingredients that you always need when you're using fiber reactive dyes are water, the dye, and soda ash. I'm going to do another video showing you the different times that you can add soda ash to your fabric. But without soda ash, the dye does not become permanently embedded in the fiber. It's absolutely essential. I'm going to start pouring the dye, and because I don't want any additional dye on this shirt, I'm going to wear something that I don't mind gets a little dye on it if I happen to make a splash. Oh, one other thing I forgot to mention. I will be washing both of these numerous times in the washing machine to get the excess dye out. And I have a safety pin that I'm going to use, I think, to mark the damp fabric. So I'll put the safety pin just on the edge of the damp fabric. That way, when all of the washing and rinsing is completed, I'll be able to remember which was which. I'm also going to use really sturdy rubber gloves. I don't recommend you use real thin doctor's office type gloves, because if your fingernail happens to puncture them, you will end up with a blue finger for a good number of days. Water mixed with soda ash, dye already mixed with water. I'm going to pour the dye solution into the soda ash solution, and then put approximately equal amounts into both of the buckets. You can use a glass measuring cup, they're not going to stain, and actually you'll find that your plastic containers don't stain either using the fiber reactive dye. So let's start with the dry fabric first. We're going to pour this on. And we'll have enough dye in the bucket to dampen most of the fabric, but it's not going to be floating in dye. So two of these pint measuring cups of dye. We'll do the same thing with the damp fabric. I think you'll be surprised at the difference in the modeling pattern between the wet and the dry dye. The wet and the dry fabric. Let's put a little more in here. There we go. Now this is really going to be a beautiful, brilliant blue. I'll show you what it looks like. Both fabrics are saturated, but the dye isn't floating around, and I'm only going to press the fabric very gently once into the dye solution. We'll now let this set for a couple of hours. When I come back, I'll show you what each piece looks like before it's rinsed out.
See you soon.
Well, it's been about an hour and a half since we added the dye to the fabric. Next step is to submerge the fabrics in cold water, which will stop the dyeing process. For two reasons. First of all, fiber reactive dyes, while they're called cold water dyes, they really need temperatures of at least 70 degrees. Taking them down below 70 degrees will stop the dyeing process. Secondly, the cold water bath will dilute the soda ash solution, and that will also stop the dyeing. So let's take a look at the bucket that had our dry fabric in it. I can see, maybe difficult for you to see at this point, but we do have some modeling, some places where the dye did not soak in because of the folds of the fabric. I'm going to take this and submerge it in the cold water, stop the dyeing process. Now there's going to be a lot of dye left in the fabric that needs to be washed out so that it doesn't bleed in the laundry. So this is our first piece. Then we'll take the fabric that was placed in the dye bath wet. Can't see a lot of difference right now. We'll submerge that, stop the dyeing process. And the next step is going to be a lot of washing. I will put it in the washing machine in a cold water bath to rinse out most of the excess dye. I'll then run it through the washer in a hot wash with no detergent. That will remove even more of the unattached dye. And then finally, I will use a special detergent made for dyeing fabric. I'm using Synthrapol, but that keeps the excess dye molecules suspended in the water so that you don't get any additional dyeing while it's in the hot wash water. I'll then rinse, and if there's still dye floating around, if I have blue tinted rinse water, I'll wash it again with very hot water and Synthrapol. You need to keep washing newly dyed fabric until you don't have any color in your rinse water. Once that's complete, I will probably use a fabric softener specifically made for dyeing fabric that gives a beautiful soft hand to the fabric. I'll dry the fabric, and then I'll show you what it looks like after it's completely dry. Time to show you our results. This is the fabric that was completely dry when we added the dye solution. Not terribly interesting, although if I had crumpled up the material a little more tightly, we might have gotten a more interesting look. But the dye was able to penetrate all of the fiber as the water spread throughout the dry fabric. On the other hand, I'm much happier with the piece that was wet when we put the dye on. We have a lot of modeling with the white and various shades of blue. In this case, the water in the fabric acted as a resist. Because there was already water in the fabric, the dye solution was not able to penetrate evenly throughout the fabric because the existing water held it back. Real happy with this piece, and this will definitely go up on Etsy. This first fabric, while it's fine, it doesn't pop. So this is a great candidate for over dyeing, and that's what we'll talk about next. Thanks a lot for watching.